You have stickability here. Circumstances of darkness doesn't cause you not to pursue the brave. I want Mary in my team also because she recognizes leadership. The Bible says that she ran to, not Thomas, not Judas, but she ran to two men, Peter and John, as I stated last week. I'll bring this out just a bit more. The leadership of the church, it says something. Running to the leadership, the potential leaders, the ordained leaders. How easy it is in church life when we address the right people with the right covenant. Not to any and anyone, but she ran to the leaders. She ran to Peter and to John. What I want to encourage women is this. Always also have more than one man in your life. Have more than one man in your life. I cannot give my wife everything. The totality of me is not sufficient for my wife. Women need legitimate men friendship. And she had that in Peter and John. Women need covering. She didn't go on broadcast. She went to the right people. So that if anything was to happen, the leaders know. Run to Peter and John. Peter with a passion. John is a bit more logistic, more settled, more stable. Peter is a bit erratic sometimes, a bit impulsive. It's not wrong to have people like that in your circle. Have both. Have both. Not just one person, not just one man. Have both. You know, I'm beginning to see this, that there's some things that I can give, but there's other things that I can't give. And another person will give that where I'm lacking. Sandwich yourself between those two apostles, as it were. This is not to say that men are greater than women, or women greater than men. What I want to say is this, that both are great, but together we are greater. Together we are greater. Mary wasn't a feminist to say, well, the tomb is empty. I've been told to go and tell Peter and the apostles. She wasn't a feminist to go and tell her lady friends. She obeyed the instruction and she went to the right people. She didn't boss it over men, but she went to those who were deemed leaders of the church. Well, a man walked into a bookstore and asked the woman behind the counter, have you got a book called Man, the Master of Women? The woman replied, try the fiction section. This is not mastery, but this is men and women working together. We are not greater than our women folk, believe you me. And neither is our women folk greater than us. But our friends, what Jesus and the gospel says is this, that there's no male nor female, but we are joint heirs in the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no male nor female, there's no Greek, there's no Gentile, there's no Greek, there is no Jew. Christ has broken down the wall between man and woman, and we can seize the opportunity to see and declare the kingdom of God together. You are joint heirs with us. Our blessings will be your blessing. Your blessing will be ours. Mary was respectful to authority, and she did not compromise. She went and told the relevant people. I like Mary also, and I want her in my team because she asks the right question. The Bible says she asks, "Where have they laid my Lord?" And that's the question we asked last week. Where have you put Jesus? Is Jesus just a sentimental attachment? Is he just a borrowed figure? Is he just a charm? So if I want something good, I want to be successful, then I use his name? But is he central to our activity and to who we are as people? I want to encourage you as we have our programs this year, whatever they are, put Jesus at the center of everything. Mm-hmm. Put Jesus at the center of our pampering day. Yeah. Put Jesus at the center of our prayer meetings. Mm-hmm. Put Jesus at the center of our business. Mm-hmm. Put Jesus at the center of our plan. Mary asks, where have they put my Lord? Where have they placed him? Such was her passion. And such was her search, even though she was looking for a dead body, not realizing that the resurrection had come. None of them had believed, but yet she pursued someone who was dead with a passion. Where have they laid Jesus? Can we lay him at our pampering day on the 27th of May? Jesus is the center, he's the most colorful figure. Whether we use, whatever we use in our pampering, whether it's foot wash or foot spa, whatever is going to be done with the face, whatever is going to be done with the back, the massage things, amen? Mm-hmm. Let us put him at the center. Do you know that through that people can come to Christ?
Yes.
That you can beautify the meek with your expertise? With handling of their bodies, as it were, their face, their nails? Do you know someone can be touched? Can I have an amen? Amen here, brothers
amen.
And sisters.
Amen.
And it can result in their own coming to the light of the gospel. I want Mary to be in my team. I want Mary to be in my team, John 20, verse 13. When Jesus said to her, "Woman, don't weep," or "Why are you weeping?" Women are known to cry quite easily and be affected by things that men may not be affected by. But because of that nature, they're able to cradle and to stomach and to carry many things. Jesus in John chapter 20, verse 30, says to her, "No woman, no cry, but mine."
Mm-hmm.
"No woman, no cry. Why are you weeping?" Until the revelation broke in that very garden where the tomb was, when she thought that this man was the gardener, and it was not the gardener, it was Jesus.
Mm.
What I want to say to you is this: let us see each other in a different and in a true light. Mary didn't recognize Jesus. He had transformed. His body was different. Do you realize this, that the resurrection is the most powerful thing on the earth? Jesus came out of his wrappings. They had put linen around him, strips. That's how they used to bury people in the past. Strips and embalm them and put spices onto them. Just like spices are going to be put on you on the 27th of May. I tell you, if I'm preaching that weekend, I'll be the sweetest man around. Hey. Hey, Brute will have nothing on me. Chanel number 5 will have nothing on me. I will be plastered and injected with shea butter and all the lovely things that you ladies do. Hey. But incidentally, or practically rather, when a body was buried in a tomb or placed in a tomb, strips of linen was wrapped around them. And listen to what happened. When the disciples went in, they were amazed in what they saw. They were startled. Because if you could imagine a cocoon of strips around a body, what they saw in the tomb was a cocoon of strips that was still intact. That means Jesus, in the resurrection, burst through those veils of cocoon. Do you understand what I'm saying? He bursts through. Nothing can wrap you up that Jesus cannot give you resurrection to. Nothing. So they were amazed that, listen, the cocoon is still left intact. He didn't strip them off. The power of his resurrection life burst through those veils and those trappings. And what they did see as evidence, as forensic evidence for those who study things, is that they saw that the head wrapping was also still intact. And so therefore the accusation that robbers will come and steal the body, robbers don't come and steal a body and leave the cocoon wrapped. They will unstrip the cocoon and take the body out. But the body, I tell you, you are a miracle. That was the ancient way of doing things, wrapping the body. The Muslims still do it. They wrap the body. And Jesus came out of that. Let's lift our hands and say, nothing is going to stop me. Nothing is going to stop me. Height nor depth is not going to stop me. Things present or things to come will not stop me. Peril will not stop me. I am going all the way. Hallelujah. I'm going all the way until break dawns. Hey, the breaking of dawn, and the light has fully come. The resurrection is you and I to be participators of that. No woman, no bride. Let us see each other in a different and true light. The work of pastoring is to see in you what you don't see in yourself. Mary saw Jesus, didn't recognize him until he spoke her name and says, Mary. Sometimes we look at each other in not the true light that we should look into. But when we are blinkered, what I've learned in pastoring, if you concentrate on the bad, you will never see the good. If you concentrate on a person's fault and concentrate on it and concentrate on it, you will be too critical. You've got to see something else that sometimes the person is not seeing. And the work of pastoring is this: always try to push people to where they can be, to where they can reach. Keep pushing them to the altitude. Keep pushing them to the premier division. Keep pushing them. Sunderland has gone. Arsenal is going up. Tottenham is going up. Second in the Premiership, I believe. Still close enough to take Chelsea over. Hello. Amen. Keep pushing up. Please turn to your neighbors and says, keep pushing up. Keep pushing up. Go to the next level.
Next level.
Keep pressing up. Tell that person, you're no longer the gardener. See each other in a beautiful light that represents us. And you don't need to go to Specsavers. All you need is Jesus. All you need is Jesus. Grasp the moment. And lastly, I like Mary because she recognized her name. It's until Jesus called her name that she recognized that he wasn't the gardener, he was the resurrected Lord. There's something about your name. I am trusting that some of you will have products that will be named after you. I'm trusting that. Amen? Could somebody say amen, Pastor? I'm believing for that. I'm throwing it out there. I'm throwing it out there. Yeah? Beyonce wrote a great song. Say my name, say my name, say my name, say my name. I don't know what the circumstances was around when she said say my name, say my name. Whether her boyfriend was with her and shouldn't have been somewhere and they've been there together, he's calling Carol instead of Beyonce. So just say my name, say my name, say my name. Come on, let's all say it. Say my name.
Say my name.
Say my name. Say my name. Say my name. Jesus knows us, my sheep knows my voice. He knows your name.
Yes.
Your name has perfume in it. Your name has legacy in it. Hallelujah. Your name has power in it.
Yes.
Your name has influence in it.
Yes.
Your name has a gathering feel in it. You must protect your name. You must pay attention to your product. And as I said to you, and I could say it unashamedly today, that one day I've been saying it for years, one day Mr. Patel is going to make rice and peas and sell it back to us. He's going to make jollof rice and sell it back to us. He's going to make jerk chicken and sell it back to us. What's so big about coconut oil that we grew up with it? Yet Holland and Barrett has taken it and sanctified it and beautified it and bottled it and sent it back to us. Am I crazy? I need some entrepreneurs and some names. If I could quickly, I don't know whether I could get through this, but it's only sent to me today. I heard about this, and let me read it in Discovery. The story of Colonel Sanders, founder of the restaurants, KFC. At 5 years old, he lost his father. At 16, he dropped out of school. At 17, he was fired from 4 jobs. At 18, he got married and became a railroad conductor. At 19, he became a father to a little girl. At 20, his wife left him and took their 1-year-old baby daughter with her. At 22, he joined the army and applied to law school, but was forced out and rejected. He then became an insurance salesman. Another brother to be added to his messy past. He decided to be a cook and a dishwasher at a small cafe. At 65 years old, he retired. On the first day of the retirement, he received a check from the government for $105. What a slap in the face. How could he survive on a $105 monthly budget, he thought, at such an old age? Feeling like a total failure, he decided to commit suicide. He sat under a tree writing his suicide letter and will. Then all of a sudden he thought of writing instead what he would have accomplished had he had the choice to start his life all over. Business plan, perhaps. He realized there was so much he hadn't yet done. One thing he realized that he could do like no one can. Actually, he could do it better than everyone else. That was cooking. Cooking the best chicken anyone had ever tasted. He borrowed $87 to buy a fryer and his recipe's ingredients. He lived on this unique fried chicken recipe, trying to sell it door to door to his neighbors in Kentucky, as well as to the license, as well as licensing it to the restaurants. Pay attention, I guess. He was rejected yet again, 1,009 times, from the restaurants he tried to license his recipe to. On the 1,010th time, restaurant gave him his license, KFC was born. At 88, Colonel Sanders became a multi-billionaire, and KFC the second biggest chicken store. Now KFC has 20,000 locations in 122 countries. The moral of the story, you have what it takes to be successful. Don't give up. It's never too old to dream.
Yes.
Go after your wildest dreams, as Mary did, searching for Christ. Believe in the quality of what you do and in yourself, no matter how many times you get rejected. Make a difference and enhance people's lives.
Though sometimes it's taunted, KFC can't find the chicken. It's not true. We still eat the chicken. Rejected. But with a passion that calls him not to give up. Nearly committed suicide, and yet he made it in his
This week, the story of three women. Teresa, May, in the heart of Labour country, Wales, wanting to turn the red into blue. Tough job, but she's a strong woman as she leads this nation. The second lady is Ivanka, the first daughter of President Trump, advisor to the president. She supports her father, and she wields significance, says someone's people, influence with her father. And the last one that I think and would say I most admire this week is Madeleine, the parents of Madeleine McCann, Kate and Jerry McCann, whose daughter disappeared at the age of three. But this is it. They've never given up the search for their daughter. 11 million has been spent. Countless investigations. And yet, Kate and Jerry McCann still dreams that Madeleine will one day be found. Let's stand. I'm impressed with that tenacious search. Not giving up, but pursuing her dream that her daughter is still alive. No matter what the opposition and some of the hardness and accusation, people will say, give up, and accuse them of many things, yet Kate and Jerry still are pursuing madly. Where have we put Jesus? Where have we placed him? Jesus is the biggest success story that we can ever have. And so I'm asking you to embrace the dream and the passion in this church called the Apostolic Church. Gifted people, gifted men and women, come on a journey with Christ. Come on a journey with Christ. Come, because it's only the most passionate who finds him. The greatest reward that Mary could ever have is that she found Jesus, and the Bible states clearly that she was the first one who saw his resurrection. First in many ways, in two ways. First, in discovering the resurrected empty tomb. First, in seeing Jesus, and first in being the social media to communicate to his disciples, tell my disciples that he's risen. People of color, be the first. Kala Ashanda Mama Santa. Be the first. Come on. Be the first. Don't beat yourself up. Be the first. You've got many talents, many gifts. They need to be managed, yes, they need to be in the right hands, the Peter and John. There are people whose hands you need help to help you with your products and the faith story that you have that is so rich. Father, I pray that the people I speak today too will hear not only my words but my spirit, to journey with me, to journey with the dream that I have, to journey more so with your dream, Lord, to crown you the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, that you are matchless, that you are God, that you are able to do the impossible, that you are able to break out of tombs, that you are able to bring harmony to those things that will see to destroy us. In all of this, you are triumphant over the grave. And I pray for the power of the resurrection to be evident in the Apostolic Church Walthamstow. That people will see the glory of God. Amen. They will see the shining light of Jesus. Amen. The truth, the life, the victory, the joy. regardless of what circumstances that prevail, we will see the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
And amen. God bless you. God bless you.